The Book of Tobit, Chapter 1. Tobit was from the tribe and city of Naphtali, which is in the upper parts of Galilee, above Asher, after the way which leads to the west, that has its city left of Sephet. Although he had been taken captive in the days of Shalmaneser, the king of the Assyrians, even in such a situation as captivity, he did not desert the way of truth. So then every day, all that he was able to obtain, he bestowed on his fellow captive brothers who were from his kindred. And when he was among the youngest of any in the tribe of Naphtali, he showed not so much as any childish behavior in his work. And then when all went to the golden calves which Jeroboam, the king of Israel, had made, he alone fled from the company of them all. Yet he continued on to Jerusalem, to the temple of the Lord. And there he adored the Lord God of Israel, offering faithfully all his first fruits and his tithes. So then, in the third year, he administered all his tithes to new converts and to new arrivals. These and similar such things, even as a boy, he observed according to the law of God. Truly, when he had become a man, he received as wife Anna of his own tribe, and he conceived a boy by her, to whom he assigned his own name. From his infancy, he taught him to fear God and to abstain from all sin. Therefore, when, during the captivity, he had arrived with his wife and son at the city of Nineveh with all his tribe, even though they all ate from the foods of the Gentiles, he guarded his soul and never was contaminated with their foods. And because he was mindful of the Lord with his whole heart, God gave him favor in the sight of Shalmaneser, the king, and he gave him the power to go wherever he would want, having the freedom to do whatever he wished. Therefore, he continued on to all who were in captivity, and he gave them helpful advice. And when he had arrived at Rages, a city in Midis, he had 10 talents of silver. From that which he had been given in honor by the king, and when in the midst of the great tumult of his kindred, he saw the destitution of Gebal, who was from his tribe, he loaned him, under a written agreement, the aforementioned weight of silver. In truth, after a long time, Shalmaneser, the king, died, while Sennacherib, his son, reigned in his place, and he held a hatred for the sons of Israel. Every day, Tobit traveled through all his own people, and he consoled them, and he distributed to each one as much as he could from his resources. He nourished the hungry, and he supplied clothes to the naked, and he showed concern for the burial of the dead and of the slain. And then when King Sennacherib had returned from Judea, fleeing the scourge which God had caused all around him because of his blasphemy and being angry, he was slaughtering many from the sons of Israel. Tobit buried their bodies. And when it was reported to the king, he ordered him to be slain, and he took away all his belongings. In truth, Tobit, fleeing with nothing but his son and his wife, was able to remain hidden because many loved him. In truth, after 45 days, the king was slain by his own sons, and Tobit was able to return to his house, and all his resources were restored to him. Chapter 2. In truth, after this, when there was a feast day of the Lord, and a good dinner had been prepared in the house of Tobit, he said to his son, "Go and bring some others who fear God from our tribe to feast with us." And after he had gone, returning, he reported to him that one of his sons of Israel, with his throat cut, was lying in the street, and immediately he leapt from his place reclining at table and left behind his dinner and went forth with fasting to the body. And taking it up, he carried it in secret to his house so that after the sun had set, he might bury him cautiously. And after he had hidden the body, he chewed his bread with mourning and fear, remembering the word that the Lord spoke through the prophet Amos, "Your feast days shall be turned into lamentation and mourning." Truly, when the sun had set, he went out and he buried him. Yet all his neighbors argued with him, saying, "Now when an order was given to execute you because of this matter, and you barely escaped a death sentence, and again you were burying the dead." But Tobit, fearing God more than the king, stole away the bodies of the slain and concealed them in his house. And in the middle of the night, he buried them. But it happened one day, being tired from burying the dead, he came into his house and he threw himself down next to the wall and he slept. And as he was sleeping, warm droppings from a swallow's nest fell upon his eyes and he was made blind. And so the Lord permitted this trial to befall him in order that an example might be given to posterity of his patience, which is even like that of holy Job. For even from his infancy, he had always feared God and kept his commandments, so that not discouraged before God because of the scourge of blindness that had befallen him. But he remained immovable in the fear of God, giving thanks to God all the days of his life. For just as kings have mocked blessed Job, so also his relatives and acquaintances ridiculed his life, saying, "Where is your hope on behalf of which you give alms and bury the dead?" In truth, Tobit corrected them, saying, "Do not speak in this way, for we are the sons of the holy ones, and we look forward to that life which God will give to those who never change in their faith before him." In truth, his wife Anna went out to weaving work daily, and she brought back the provisions that she was able to obtain by the labor of her hands. Whereupon it happened that, having received a young goat, she brought it home. When her husband heard the sound of its bleating, he said, "Look, so that it might not be stolen, return it to its owners, for it is not lawful for us either to eat or to touch anything stolen." At this, his wife, being angry, answered, "Clearly your hope has become vanity, and the manner of your almsgiving has become apparent." And with these and other similar such words, she reproached him. Chapter 3. Then Tobit sighed, and he began to pray with tears, saying, "Oh Lord, you are just in all your judgments. Are just in all your ways of mercy and truth and judgment. Now, O Lord, remember me, and do not take vengeance on my sins, and do not call to mind my nor those of my parents. For we have not obeyed your precepts, and so we have been handed over to plundering and to captivity and to death and to mockery, and as a disgrace before all the nations among which you have dispersed us. And now, O Lord, great are your judgments, for we have not acted according to your precepts, and we have not walked sincerely before you. And now, O Lord, do with me according to your will, and order my spirit to be received in peace. For it is more expedient for me to die than to live. And so on the same day it happened that Sarah, the daughter of Raguah, in Rages, a city in the Medes, also heard a reproach from one of her father's servants' maids. For she had been given to 7 husbands, and a demon named Asmodeus had killed them as soon as they approached her. Therefore, when she corrected the maid for her fault, she answered her, saying, "May we never see son or daughter from you upon the earth, you murderess of your husbands. Will you also kill me, just as you have already killed 7 husbands?" These words she proceeded to an upper room of her house, and for 3 days and 3 nights she did not eat or drink, but continuing in prayers with tears, she beseeched God so that he would liberate her from this reproach. And it happened on the 3rd day, while she was completing her prayer, blessing the Lord, that she said, "Blessed is your name, O God of our fathers. Although you have been angry and will show mercy, in time of tribulation you dismiss the sins of those who call upon you. To you, O God, I turn my face. To you I direct my eyes. I beg you, O Lord, that you may absolve me from the chains of this reproach, or at least take me away from the earth. You know, O Lord, that I have never coveted a husband, and I have preserved my soul clean from all impure desire. I have never mingled myself with those who play, and I have not presented myself as a participant with those who walk with levity. But I consented to accept a husband in your fear, not in my lust. And either I was unworthy of them, or they perhaps were not worthy of me. For perhaps you have preserved me for another husband, for your counsel is not within the ability of man. But all who worship you are certain of this, that one's life, if it should be tested, shall be crowned, and if it should be in tribulation, shall be delivered, and if it should be corrected, shall be permitted to approach your mercy. For you are not delighted with our perdition, for after a storm you create tranquility, and after tears and weeping you pour out exaltation. May your name, O God of Israel, be blessed forever." At that time, the prayers of them both were heard in the sight of the glory of the Most High God, and the holy angel of the Lord, Raphael, was sent to care for both of them, whose prayers were recited at the same time in the sight of the Lord. Chapter 4. Therefore, when Tobit considered that his prayer was heard, so that he might be able to die, he called his son Tobias to him, and he said to him, "My son, hear the words of my mouth, and set them like a foundation in your heart. When God will receive my soul bury my body, and you shall honor your mother for all the days of her life, for you are obliged to be mindful of what great peril she suffered because of you in her womb. But when she too will have completed the time of her life, bury her near me, yet for all the days of your life, have God in your mind, and be careful that you never consent to sin, nor overlook the precepts of the Lord our God. Give alms from your substance, and do not turn away your face from any pauper, for so it shall be that neither the face of the Lord be turned away from you. And in whatever way that you are able, so shall you be merciful. If you have much, distribute abundantly. And if you have little, nevertheless, strive to bestow a little freely. For you store up for yourself a good reward for the day of necessity. For almsgiving liberates from every sin and from death. It will not suffer the soul to go into darkness. Almsgiving will be a great act of faith before the Most High God for all those who practice it. Take care to keep yourself, my son, from all fornication, and except for your wife, never permit yourself to know such an offense. Never permit arrogance to rule in your mind and in your words, for in it all perdition had its beginning. And whoever has done any kind of work for you, immediately pay him his wages, and do not let the wages of your hired hand remain with you at all. Whatever you would hate to have done to you by another, see that you never do so to another. Eat your bread with the hungry and the needy, and cover the naked with your own garments. Set out your bread and your wine at the burial of a just man, and do not eat or drink from it with sinners. Always seek the counsel of a wise man. Bless God at all times, and petition him that he direct your ways, and that all your counsels remain in him. And now I reveal to you, my son, that I lent 10 talents of silver while you were still a young child to Gebal in Rages, a city of the Medes, and I have his written agreement with me. And so inquire how you may travel to him and receive from him the aforementioned weight of silver, and return to him the written agreement. Do not be afraid, my son. We do indeed lead a poor life, but we will have many good things. If we fear God and withdraw from all sin and do what is good,